I thought it would be relevant for us to speak just a little about death today, if you will. I have, over the last month, watched several loved ones be laid to rest. Amen. Received a phone call on last night, about 12 o'clock. Deacon Johnson's mother passed. Deacon Giles Johnson. Was here on yesterday as we laid to rest. Deacon Dickens. Amen. Just last month, we laid to rest Sister Powell. Amen. Was at a funeral just another week ago, a young lady who was less than 40 years old who suddenly dropped dead. Amen. And in watching it, I think it's important we understand that in this text, Paul makes a character distinction between believers and non-believers. Amen. He makes a character distinction between believers. He refers to non-believers, listen now, as those who have no hope. And in doing so, Paul doesn't tell them not to grieve. No, he didn't tell them not to grieve, but he said not to grieve, he did, but simply says our grieving ought to be different than somebody else's. Amen. Paul allows us the privileges of being human. You're human. However, he states that there ought to be something unique about our grieving. Amen. Too often we want God to change the temperature around us without changing around others. Amen. We want God to allow the sun to shine on us while it's raining on somebody else. Amen. We want God to feed us while somebody else is hungry. In short, we want others to go through trials and tribulations while we are still cool, calm, and relaxed. But I'm convinced that every now and then God allows a tornado to touch down in our life. He permits a hurricane to disrupt our happy home. He ushers an earthquake in to shake the foundation of our lives that we may fall to our knees and call upon Him.
Yes.
Too many of us want a resurrection without having gone through a crucifixion. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And in the midst of all that we're going through, we cry out, why me, Lord? Why not you? What was it you said, God's always stood by my side and been my guide? Why not you? Wasn't it you said, 'tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to believe in His word? Why not you? Wasn't it you said, I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses? Wasn't that you? Why not you? Well, what did you say? Shake, shake, shake. Shake the devil off. He's under my feet.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, wasn't that? Why not you? So Paul reminds the Thessalonians, don't think that being a Christian means that you're not going to grieve.
Okay.
Don't think that being a Christian means that you're not going to go through some things just not going to go through like those that have no hope.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. The mailman is still going to drop bills at your house that you can't pay just like everybody else. There's still going to be trouble in your way, and you will have to cry sometimes.
Amen. Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Yes.
Paul wants us to know that no one fully escapes the shadow of grief. Everyone lives, sooner or later, you're going to grieve. You're going to go through something. Amen.
Amen.
To grieve the deep mental anguish over loss of sorrow to meet with disaster.
Yes.
You're going to go through something to experience hurt.
Yes.
Now, there was a time in ministry I thought I was immune to going through certain things. Then one day in 1999, my father died. And I found myself grieving. I found myself going through the same stages that anybody who loses somebody. For a moment, there was a moment I got angry at God. God, why couldn't he stay with me just a little while long? But then God had to remind me that back in 1991 when he first had the stroke and he was in a coma, and I went to God, I said, God, allow him to live long enough to see his firstborn his grandson who will be named after him. I asked God to do that, and God honored that prayer. Not only that, but then in 1995, God gave me a second child, and my father was able to see both children.
Amen. Bring it on, God.
Bring it on. I didn't have the right no reason to be mad at God. But I was grieved. We grieve because our law, Revelation tells us that in heaven, that there be no more grief. Reason that there be no more grief because there be no more loss.
Yes.
When our lives are no longer disrupted by loss, there be no more grief.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
When we grieve when we lose our money, we grieve when we lose our jobs, our health, our homes, our friends, our children, our husband, our wives, our parents, our siblings. We grieve when our dreams turn into nightmares. We grieve sometimes.
Yes. Yes, Lord. Yes. Yes.
We grieve when we lose that which we have learned to love. The more we love, the more we grieve.
Yes.
Anybody listening to
us? Yes.
We listen.
Yes.
Now watch this. Grief is the price that we pay for loving deeply. Grief is the price that we pay for loving deeply. But there are times that grief becomes a gift from God.
Yes.
For if we had not loved them, we would not grieve.
Amen.
Amen. Did anybody hear that?
Yes.
Amen.
So the trade-off, would you rather have that love or would you rather have that grief?
My God.
Grief hurts. But can you imagine life without the capacity to love?
Yes.
And love without the capacity to grieve. I would rather have the capacity to remember and feel grief than forget and feel nothing.
Yes. Yes.
My grieving is not a sign of my weakness. My grieving is a sign of my strength. That's why I tell folk all the time, the worst thing you can tell folk when they're grieving is don't cry. No, let them cry. Right. Because when you say don't cry, what you're saying is don't grieve. And it is if you're disciplining them for having love. Grief becomes a gift from God. It relieves us to know that God has allowed us to love to the point that now we can grieve. That grief becomes our source of relief. Grief in some strange way, in some inexplicable, indefinable way, becomes hope that's changed. Watch this. And our grief begins to draw us closer to God.
Amen.
Our grief can and does somehow search to open up our lives to the good God of goodness, grace, and hope. Even this morning is evident when I look at Sister Dickens in the audience this morning. She lost her husband, but yet she's allowed that to draw her even closer to God. She here doesn't want because nobody made her come. I don't think that much you can make her do. Amen. She's here because she wanted to be here. Why? Because she wants to restore her relationship with God. Somehow I grieve she to put us where God can have a chance with us. We are thrust by our grief into something deeper than our trouble. Amen.
Amen.
Greater than our despair. More enduring than our pain. I don't need to tell our 2020 to come to church and bring Isaiah. Sister Paula told him enough. And that name will forever echo in his ear because he loved her enough to listen to what she had to say. Some of us have no time for God when all is well, but then our world is disrupted and the sun moves. The stable ground beneath our feet slips. And everything comes apart. Someone we love is lost. It's gone. And in the midst of our darkness, we open our lives to God. When my father died, he did something to my ministry. Caused me to become more trusting and more dependent on God than I had ever been. Couldn't pick up the phone and call him in the morning. Listen to him encourage me to press on. And so I found myself looking to God even more. And God kept telling me, go on, son, go, go. And then I can open up that heaven and say, this is my beloved son, whom I will please. I begin to look at God for verification and validation of who I was. I begin to look to him for which they all of my help. Begin to talk to God like we've never talked to God before.
Say so.
Grief becomes our source of relief to our trouble. God works in our lives through our brokenness. God puts our lives back together. Pieces that didn't fit begin to fit again. Why? Because we begin to look to God for direction and guidance.
Yes. Say so.
Things that didn't make sense.
understand?
Sister, some of you lost your husband just almost a year ago. But now she's out in the church almost every Sunday.
Right.
Looking to God. Strength, power, and direction. Sometimes grief becomes our source of relief.
That's up.
This past week, she went down DMV, got the lines from me. She ain't need no man to read a lot. She can wake him up, tell him, go get it. Amen. But now she come to conclude that I don't have no husband, I need me a cop. Are you listening to me? Sometimes God has a way of getting our attention. That was a man who was a great jazz composer. One day while he was on tour, he received a phone call that his wife had been killed in a terrible automobile accident. And he sat down in his grief. And no jazz song could minister to the hurt and pain that he was going through.
Come on, Pastor. Come on, Pastor.
So Thomas A. Dorsey began to write. And he had never wrote a gospel song before. Ain't nobody wrote. Precious Lord, take my hand. Lead me on. Let me stand. I am tired. I am weak. I am worn. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand, lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me on.
Precious Lord, precious Lord, precious Lord.
He didn't sit there and write a blues song or jazz song. He looked to God from which came his help. He said, when the doctors appeared and the night draws near, the day is past. Even Isaiah says, in the year that King Isaiah died, I
shall the Lord high and lift it up. But it wasn't until the year that King Isaiah died that he saw the Lord, because he was so busy looking at King Isaiah for his help. Amen. God will turn your midnight today. Want to know it?
Yes, sir.
Want to make a way for you? You can trust God and His word. Want to pick you up, turn you around, put your feet on solid ground. Want God make a way for you? I don't know about you, but I thank Him for the river.
Yes.
I thank Him for the valley.
Yes.
I thank Him for the storm. Somebody said, if I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that God could solve them. I wouldn't know what faith in God to do. I wouldn't know what trusting God could do.
Oh, yes.
But through